This is the label which you can find, and we define 5 stars. Next, please. Yeah, next, please. The energy conservation building code, the building efficiency has assumed a great importance in last almost 5 to 6 years. In India, it has started a good popularity, and there is a capacity building going on. The architects and building professionals are given a published code which can define the different construction and the design parameter for any building, which they can use it. The consumer is happy because they are going to construct the building for next 20 years life, and it can save overall energy demand for the particular building, or not only the electricity demand, but any other kind of demand. Next, please. Yeah, next, please. Next, please. Next, please. I think it's, yeah. Okay. The most important or the most successful program on the industry side has been the PAT, the Perform, Achieve, and Trade. Today, the cement industries in India are most efficient in the world. They have become efficient as a result of PAT program. They were given a target of 5% to 6% or sometimes 8% to improve. They decided to transform their technologies, and they improved somewhere 8%, 12%, or sometimes 14%. Because when they wanted to do the investment, they decided, why can't we invest in a technology which is the best in the world? And that led to that most of the cement plants today have become the best in the world. This is one simple success story in the industry sector. And in industrial efficiency, India has achieved a much higher levels in last 4 to 5 years after this PAT program. Slowly we are expanding. Now the refineries have achieved almost 4% of efficiency in last 3 years. Similarly, railways have achieved 3% efficiency. The distribution companies have achieved 2% efficiency. All of them have contributed to almost 2% reduction in the country's primary energy supply. This is purely only from the industry sector or the large consumers. Only 1,000 consumers are acting on the, are participating, but these 1,000 consumers are covering 60% of the total country's consumption. So the second clue for any policymaker is that whatever policy or program is prepared, it should be applicable to as less possible as a target group, but most effective in terms of achievement. This is the second policy clue. Next, please. Next, please. Yeah. As I said, we started with first cycle with 52% coverage. Now we have more than 60%. Next, please. Yeah. We'll go to the last one. Okay. So the first cycle we achieved 1.25% savings in India's primary energy, which almost 2% CO2 reduction for the country, and 9,500 crore saving in 2016. This has already increased up to almost 20,000 crores of rupees in addition to the CO2 saving of 108 million tons of CO2. Next, please. Next, please. Yeah. Yeah, next. Yeah, next, please. If we say why these industries have actually done additional efforts, I think I didn't show the last one. Most of these industries could achieve their target, and they have exceeded their target. It's okay. They have exceeded their target by 20 to 30%. As I said, in case of cement, they could achieve almost 40%. In case of textile, the industries leverage their all low-hanging fruits, and they could achieve 70% extra over and their targets. Because they were given energy certificates. So every consumer who is able to achieve more than the target, they are allotted certificates. And these certificates are traded, and we have done 100 crore rupees of trading in the first round, and the second round will take place somewhere between March to June this year for the PAT 2 cycle, participated by 600 industries. Next, please. This is a second clue that we can always incentivize the industry or the consumers. There has to be an incentive for every consumer to promote energy efficiency as leafly. If we are going for a mandatory regime, it is always suggested that we should have some kind of incentive as well. Next, please. Next. We are running an overall mission on energy efficiency, which is what we call as Roshni, a new approach to the energy efficiency. This will be a new mission starting from 2020, and it will go up to 2030 as part of an overall national action plan on climate change. That is the India. This year we will have 11 missions. One of them will be dedicated to energy efficiency. There are other missions on Green India, solar, Himalayan, and also for the coastal mission, health mission as well. Next, please. I want to come back to the last point, which is the cooling, which is one of the area where highest consumption is expected. Next, please. Yeah. Next, please. The development which we are able to see in India have major impact on energy demand, especially on account of cooling. It is estimated that the amount of commercial building what we have today in terms of square meter, India will have same construction area added from now onwards. That means the commercial building space, whatever the India has today, will be doubled from now onwards in next 10 years. Most of them will be air-conditioned space. That means that much energy demand on the commercial air conditioning will continue, will be added. Second, today in India, we have only 7 to 8% household using air conditioners. It is expected by 2030, at least 20% household will use air conditioner. At least, we believe it may be more than that. I'm only talking about household. The demand for air conditioners, which is only about 7 million per year today, the simple unitary demand, I'm not talking about the will be almost three to four times by 2030. And that's going to have a huge impact on the energy demand in the country. How are we going to meet it? Are we going to meet again by using coal? Are we going to meet again by using oil or gas? Or are we going to be with the renewables? The best part is we should have the most air conditioners in the country. And that's where the technology has to be developed. Let's see what's happening across the world. If we can see how the AC, the air conditioner demand has grown up. And if I just talk about the slide where I said that 1.2% improvement was noticed in the world because most of the countries, US and Europe, had extreme winters and extreme summers, which increased their air conditioning demand or the building energy demand. If we can see now, China and India are going to be the biggest one having the higher demand in coming years in terms of air conditioners. And in India, it will be the highest one. As I said, in India, still we have only 6 to 7% household using air conditioners. So the only way to do this next, the only way to do is to go in for energy efficient air conditioners or have the most efficient building design so that the overall energy demand comes down. All these, otherwise, then all calculations or our policies for overall energy mix will go entirely in a different number if we don't curtail the demand from the air conditioners. It also depends on a lot of impact on the local grid, the local electricity system, the transformers, the supply system, the transmission system. And let us see what is the impact of energy demand on a day-to-day basis. Again, a little technical matter. In New Delhi, some of you know what is the peak load. The peak load comes in afternoon 2 o'clock or in the evening 10 p.m. Today in India, the power installation capacity is 365 gigawatt. But what is the peak load India encounters? Only 180. That means we have almost 50% reserve capacity in terms of installation. But peak load of 180 gigawatt is still much higher than the normal load of only 160 gigawatt. That means there is a variation from 160 gigawatt to 180 gigawatt during the peak time in a single day. Now, what does it mean? It means an additional investment required, additional infrastructure required, additional capacity and switching and all other associated cost involved in just maintaining that peak. And we can see the most prominent reason for that peak is air conditioner in India. It is the air conditioners in New Delhi, this city, which affect the power load during the daytime, especially in the summers. And that's why it is necessary to address the air conditioning as the biggest challenge for countries, not only the energy demand, but also of the total installed capacity. Next, please. Finally, what could be the potential energy saving which can happen if we again resort to the most air-conditioned design, etc. As I said, the baseline scenario, you can see the top line, the efficient cooling scenario, if we have a new technology and also best practices, including the most efficient technologies in air conditioner, as well as for the building side or a commercial air conditioners, we can achieve a very high amount of energy demand, what we have today and what we are likely to have if we don't do anything. But there are many more potential areas. Some new technologies are coming up. The refrigerants are also being changed. And there is a global challenge, India Cooling Action Plan, and also Mission Innovation, which are working on new refrigerant, including the refrigerant like CO2 or FCO, where you can have most efficient air conditioners, we can see in coming years, not only in India and elsewhere in the world also. But it is true that air conditioning demand has to be managed, has to be optimized. Otherwise, our overall energy demand calculations will definitely be, they will go wrong if we don't manage this thing. It again depends on not only the energy efficient policies, but also on the consumer behavior as well. Next, please. This is the last slide, I stop here. If we can see the 2016 and the blue column, 2016 and 2050 baseline scenario, we can reduce the CO2 emission itself in the world if China and India alone can reduce the CO2 demand by air conditioners. That is the top one here. These are the two savings which India and China alone can do it in overall global CO2 demand. And these are the other two demands where the China and India can do it. And finally, we can have again a CO2 emission level by 2050 in emission cooling scenario at this level as compared to 2016 from there. This is the impact of energy efficiency on the CO2 overall emission only account of cooling. All along, I was trying to explain you what is the role of energy efficiency on our climate change goals as well as on our overall calculations and approach towards energy transition. While we are making the energy transition, there is always a shift from one particular fuel to the another fuel, considering the fact what is the demand coming from the consumers. Most of the time, we try to project some different numbers, but actually the consumers are going or thinking in some other way. I'll just give some of the potential numbers and I'll just stop there. Next, please. Next. I'll skip it. This previous. Yeah. So in India, today we have our overall demand as 540, which is a consumption. Without any new policies, it will reach somewhere 876. These are the projections. These are all sectoral projections. Most important, they are interconnected. These calculations are done through a tool by seeing the growth and the overall potential in the different consumer segment, in the different economic sectors. And we can have almost 747 million ton as against 876, which is more than 130 million tons of saving by making different policies and different programs. Next, please. Next, same is the case for the electricity demand, which can be reduced from 2,400 up to 2,190, almost 2,200, by having different energy efficiency policies. The last thing which I wanted to explain is, whenever we are discussing the investment and the climate change and the overall power scenario or the energy scenario, we have a basic misunderstanding in terms of how the additional demand will come. I'll give a very clear example. Today, China is having the highest steel production of more than 800 million tons. India has just crossed 100 million tons. India wants to achieve another 100 million ton of steel production in next 5 years. Steel is one of the energy intensive sector. When we are planning for an additional 100 million tons of steel production in next 5 years, our energy demand in steel sector will not increase by another 100%. It will not increase by even 50%. It will only increase by 20%. This is where the energy efficiency comes into play. This is where most of the calculations are likely to go wrong. If today New Delhi has 10 million air conditioners total among all households and offices, if today this 10 million is increased to 15 million in next 2 years, the power demand due to air conditioner will not increase by 50%. It will only increase by 10%. This is one basic calculation which is done not correctly by most of the policymakers or most of the investment analysts, that whatever comes will be very efficient and whatever is replaced will be the most inefficient. If today a steel plant wants to replace its process system, they will replace the most inefficient one and they will install the most efficient one. That's the impact of energy efficiency. That's the concept of energy efficiency. If the consumer is convinced to adopt energy efficiency measures, it will have actually a real impact on overall energy demand for the country, for himself, and obviously save the world from the impact of climate change, as we are expecting in one of this SDG goal number 7, affordable and clean energy. Thank you so much.
That was a very comprehensive presentation. I'm sure I should not try to summarize it, but basically what it means is that how to have an efficient world scenario in order to achieve the Paris Agreement commitments. He has also given very clearly the example that if the reduction in energy intensity is by 1.2%, then the saving will be to the extent of $1.6 trillion. And if it is 3% instead of 1.2, it will be almost $4 trillion. He has also, without going into the details, emphasized the fact that policy changes are required and major sectors like transport sector, building sector, industry sector have to also be addressed. Without speaking more in regarding that, I would like to request Mr. Subbumai Bhattacharji, our energy expert in the RIS, to comment on, give his comments. Yeah.
That's quite magisterial, if I may use the word. In fact, all our audience here would have realized that energy sectors, what Mr. Bakre has done, is basically built up in a very painstaking way. And you know, this takes time to sort of build up the scenario analysis of what needs to be done when you want to get energy efficiency as a measure of public policy. It takes time. One has to go through, I wouldn't say hundreds, say millions of scenario building before energy efficiency becomes a part of a country's economic policy. And just as, in fact, an example from the non-economic scenario might make it easier. When we do a peace-building mission, we do several amount of these analysis of what will happen when this person does that and that person does it, and it's very fluid. Energy efficiency and energy modeling follows roughly the same principles, that you've got to build in extreme number of alternatives. And those alternatives I was impressed with, Mr. Bakri, was that fact that your essential narrative of how that efficiency structures build up is something that should be read through very carefully. And I myself must say that I learned quite a lot. I was also impressed with the fact that you were referring to the energy saving certificates, which again, that energy saving certificates business is probably the best way to ensure that energy efficiency gets built up in a country's economy. Otherwise, it doesn't reach from policy to markets without creating those energy certificates. And those certificates actually lie at the basis of how economies, countries, policies can shape up together to create a environment of energy efficiency. Just one thing is that, you know, no country is born with energy ability. Somebody may have oil, somebody may have gas, somebody may have nothing. But every country can give birth to energy efficiency. And as Mr. Bakri said, that's one of the first fuel to get. And that makes for a significant change in a country's ability to negotiate through 21st century. I think that's the bottom line of what you were saying. And thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So I think the floor is open. Any questions? Ambassador Balakrishnan.
Thank you, Dr. Bakre, for that presentation. My question is, you know, you pointed out correctly that refrigeration and air conditioning sector, the demand in India is going to go up, huge amount. Now we have a big problem because the Montreal Protocol, the Kigali Amendment, as per that, we have to phase out the refrigerants which we are now using, HCFCs and these agents, because these are extremely damaging as far as global warming is concerned. And so we have to completely re-engineer all our air conditioners. We have to think of refrigerants like ammonia, carbon dioxide, propane. Now, running an air conditioner with these refrigerants will be less efficient than what we have now. So changing the refrigerant in order to comply with the Kigali Amendment will come in the way of improving the efficiency of air conditioners, unless some very new technology comes in. So how do we handle this problem of the Kigali Amendment in the India Cooling Action Plan?
Any other question? Any other question? Yeah, please.
Give a bit of an analysis of how the states have been ranked on the energy efficiency. It has just come up recently, last week. Himachal, Karnataka, and Uttar Pradesh have done quite well. And I think that's something which has been spearheaded by BEE. And I think that's a major endeavor which you could probably take us through.
Yeah, please.
Sir, you mentioned about 600 DCs in your presentations, and probably these represent some definite sectors, but there are many other sectors which are not been included, but they are also can contribute towards reducing the energy intensity. So what's your plan? First question. And second question is this assessment of the previous cycles. That also takes a longer time. And as we go to the different cycles, the delta improvement will become more and more difficult. So how to incentivize the industry further for reducing those targets?
I think, yeah.
So then we'll take. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Ambassador Balakrishna. Very rightly said. And after the India Cooling Action Plan, where BEE was actively involved in shaping up this, even though this plan was as part of Kigali amendment and the where there is a requirement to also not only plan the phase out of HFCs, but at the same time improve the energy efficiency of the air conditioning system or space conditioning. Coupled with that, the mission innovation, as Mr. Augustine has said, I am Sherpa for SEM, Clean Energy Ministerial. There is another platform which is called Mission Innovation, which was launched by our Honorable Prime Minister during the Paris Agreement event at Paris, which is Mission Innovation, again a countries of actually leveraging and promoting innovations in the energy efficiency area. So as part of that, in 2018, a cooling reward challenge has been initiated, and this has been just awarded on 15th of November by Dr. Harshvardhan, our minister environment that time. And in that, it's good to see, in fact I am happy to announce that there was a challenge that we have to develop an air conditioner which is having 1/5 of climate impact against the baseline air conditioner, the average air conditioner being sold in India. It is good that this, even though it was a global challenge, it was created on India's basic parameters. So we took India's average air conditioner which is being sold, which is approximately 3-star, and the challenge was that the new air conditioner which is to be developed should be 1/5 having 1/5 impact on climate and 1/4 in terms of energy demand. Then it was also given it should be non-ODS refrigerant. Initially there were 1,000 entries. Out of that, 100 entries were shortlisted. Finally, 8 designs have been approved, and now they are in the development and trial phase. And sir, let me tell you, there were one or two designs which did not use refrigerant at all. So we can see that if a global challenge, and the best part of that, that BEE is trying to get these 8 designs tried in India, and I am sure after 2 to 3 years, India will have much higher efficiency in air conditioners, including the problem of new refrigerant. So that's that will be a new thing, and that's why we are going to actually address the demand on air conditioner. Can I just answer that? Yeah, very clearly, and perhaps I said, we want to achieve almost 75% of our energy consumption in the mandatory policies. We want to leave the 25%. We don't want to go into more and more consumers to a very small level, because monitoring them, then making new targets will be very difficult. It will also put some kind of a restriction on them. But all new sectors, we have included airports, petrochemicals. We are in the process of including sugar. Then chemical sector, all these new sectors will be included one by one. Their assessment will be much streamlined. And as you have very rightly said, same industry, if they are given targets repeatedly, their margin will be less. But then, as I just replied for air conditioner, there is always possibility to have a new technologies coming up and to give incentive. As Mr. Shubham has said, there should be some kind of additional incentive, something like energy certificate or maybe some kind of a carbon certificate to encourage everyone who is interested in saving energy or saving CO2.
Any other questions?
Yeah, there is a, as I s- there was a small slide, Bureau, the one which I am heading, is a regulatory body. We do not have any field offices or a regional offices or branch. So while we are the think tank as well as statutory body for the country, we have a equivalent agency or organization at every state level. As you are aware, we have 36 states plus union territories. So there are agencies, they work under our control, they discharge the mandate given to them. But India being such a vast country, so much potential, so much diversity, and so much activities going on at different sectors, at field level, most of the conservation measures or the policies have to be adopted. Like buildings is the state matter, agriculture is a state matter, transport is also a state matter more or less. So all these areas, the field level or the state level implementation has to be done. So Bureau has started all these agencies or the state level. We have only 2 days back, we have published an index. We have grouped different states in the different categories, and we have tried to find out their potential. If the state, one particular state has a more potential in agriculture and they have not issued any policy on agriculture side, energy efficiency, then we are giving less marks. If a particular state has got more potential in industry side and they are implementing their policies very nicely in the industry side, they are giving higher marks. So we have taken cross-sectoral indexes, parameters. We want to understand that at every field level or state level, how are they performing, what are the opportunities available, and what are the actions, whether they are getting implemented. So that way, we are publishing the index every year. The first one was released last week here in in New Delhi by our Honorable Minister.
If there is any more questions, I think we will conclude. I would like to thank Mr. Abhay Bakre, who has provided us with substantial information regarding the energy efficiency, how India as a role model, we have high-tech participants here. Actually, India's role, because we have also seen that UK and India, these are the two countries which figure out of the G20 countries as efficient players in the area. So this can, the presentation and whatever he has told can act as a sort of a role model for various countries, especially developing countries. So I would like to thank Mr. Bakre for being present here, and also Arjit Sengupta, who has also come all the way. I would also like to thank our DG Sachin Chaturvedi, who has taken a lot of interest when I suggested this to have this program organized here, and I would like to thank him. Mr. Subhamai Bhattacharji, who has given substantial comments on the issue, and all the participants, including those from the RIS who have participated here. Thank you very much. Yeah, we will have, all are invited to have tea here on the side.